The recording is on. So today I want to talk about accelerated methods, accelerated gradient descent method, and it's also sometimes referred to as momentum methods. Okay. So let's see what the idea of accelerated gradient descent method is. So in the steepest descent, you have xk equals to, xk plus 1 equals to xk minus alpha k dk gradient of fxk. Okay, this is the steepest descent method. Now, the question that in the steepest descent, there is no dk. It's just the alpha k multiplied by the gradient of fxk. Now, the question is, at this point of time, when you are sitting at xk plus 1, you have computed, you started with x naught, you computed gradient of fx naught, and you computed gradient of fxk. Right, so you have all this information that you are discarding at time k, and you are only using this information and the value of xk in order to compute xk plus 1. So the question that Nesterov asked in 1980s was, how about I don't discard this information that I've already computed. I have this thing available for free. What if I don't discard this information and somehow intelligently use this information in the update scheme here in order to potentially speed up the steepest descent algorithm? Okay. And, you know, some of the foundation was laid by Polyak back in 1960s. So it's not like he was asking this question in vacuum. There was some precedent of accelerated methods before him. But he made some remarkable contributions in this area. Okay, so the question now that is, can we devise an algorithm where xk equals to, or xk plus 1 equals to x0 plus some linear function of gradient of fx naught all the way to gradient of fxk. Which is faster than steepest descent. So note that I'm carefully avoiding any mention of Newton's method here, because in Newton's method, you are taking a nonlinear function of all these vectors that you have computed. So we have talked about BFGS method and DFP method. So those are all nonlinear transformation of the gradients. So I'm carefully avoiding talking about Newton's method because it's of course very fast, but I'm purely talking about linear function of the gradients. And I want to improve upon the steepest descent algorithm where your dk is actually identity matrix. So let's say I pose this question to you. How would you go about coming up with such an algorithm? What would your methodology be for developing such an algorithm? What do you think?
Could maybe do like a sliding window over the previous gradients.
Right, but then the question is, how would you pick your step sizes? I mean, that's pretty much what the question here is, but what should the step size be So sliding window is a good idea. How would you pick your step size?
So more recent gradient will have larger step size.
Okay. All right. So let's see how he approached this particular problem. Okay, so now that you've given it a thought, here is what he did. He basically made the following contribution. So number one, now of course this is coming from his book. The book's name is Introductory Lectures on Convex Optimization. This book was published in 2004 by Springer. And so this book is available for free to download as in an ebook format if you have the access to university library. So I have put up the link to this particular book in the on Carmen Canvas. So you can just download the book from there and you can take a look. So I'm going to talk about chapter 2 today of that book. Okay, so here is how he approached it. The first question he answered was, he proved that there exists a convex function f such that no, I want to say algorithm, I want to call it star, algorithm star, no algorithm of type star can How should I say it? Can improve the convergence rate beyond a limit. And he identified what that limit is. So you have a certain convergence rate and you cannot improve upon that convergence rate. And then he came up with a methodology, an algorithm, which met that convergence rate. So came up with a family of algorithms that achieves the convergence rate. So as semester progresses, my handwriting becomes worse and worse. So he basically made two contributions. The first contribution was that he came up with a convex function and he showed that no matter what, even if you pick the best algorithm in the class star, you can only do so much. So he came up with a fundamental lower bound on the performance of the algorithm in terms of rate of convergence. And then he came up with a set of algorithms which meets that rate of convergence and therefore is order optimal as far as algorithms of the type star is concerned. Okay, so what I'm going to do in today's class is I'm going to go over the methodology he adopted and the lower bounds and the upper bounds. And that's all we are going to cover in today's class. So any questions so far? All right. So let's look at the convex function case. Convex function and gradient f is Lipschitz with constant. So the Lipschitz constant is L. So let x be in Rn and k be in 1 to n. And he defined a function fk of x as L over 4, 1 over 2, x1 square plus summation I equals okay, so this is a so the claim that he makes, I mean, it's actually easy to prove. Fk is convex for every k. And remember that it's only using the first k components of the vector x. So it's not using xk plus 1, xk plus 2, all the way up to xn. Oh, you know, let me write it. X is x1 to xn. Okay, so these are the n elements of the vector x and not the iterates xk. I'm sorry, there is no better way to write it. Okay, well, is there a better way to write it? No, let me just keep it this way. Okay, so this x is a vector with n elements, right, x1 to xn, and he defines a function which only depends on the first k elements of the vector x, and it doesn't depend on the rest of the elements of vector x. And then he claims that fk is convex, and gradient of fk has Lipschitz constant L. Okay, and this is an exercise. You can do it at home. And then he goes ahead and proves the following theorem. The theorem is, let me pick fx equal to f2k plus 1x. K is less than equal to n minus 1 over 2. Okay, you can pick any. So you pick n sufficiently large. Let's say you pick a 100 dimensional vector x, and you pick k anything less than 49. Okay. He showed that if you pick any algorithm of the type star, you have the following. Any algorithm of type star, you have two results. The first result is f of xk minus f of x star is greater than or equal to 3L x0 minus x star. So this xk is the kth iterate of the gradient descent algorithm. How should I write it? Well, let me write it as yk. So this yk is the kth iterate of the gradient descent algorithm. And this is y0 minus x star over 332. K plus 1 square. That's his first result. And the second result is yk minus y star square is greater than or equal to 1 over 8. Y0 minus Y star square. Okay. There has to be a square here. Yeah, that's it.
Professor, just a question on equation one, the right hand side. Is that y zero minus y star? Is it supposed to be y zero y star?
Yeah. So x star is basically the optimal solution throughout the text. And the reason why I'm using yk is because here I'm using x1 and xk to denote the kth element of the vector. So I need a different notation to show the kth iterate of gradient descent algorithm.
Okay.
Yeah. Yes.
So when you write this theorem, f of x equal to f2k plus 1, can it be? I don't understand what this f2k plus 1 of x.
Fk of x is defined here. So you just have to substitute 2k in this. So you are using the first 2k plus 1 elements of the vector x. So fk of x is a family of functions.
Yeah, okay.
Index by k. So you're just picking the 2k plus 1th index, where k is fixed between 1 and n minus 1 over 2. Does that answer your question?
Yes.
Okay, great. So so basically I have to pick a convex function, which is Lipschitz, which has a Lipschitz gradient. So how do I pick a function? So he picked this class of function and he said, let's pick our objective function. I want to minimize with respect to x and Rn. I want to minimize this function, f of x. And the way he defined f of x is it's equal to f2k plus 1x, where f2k plus 1 is, you know, wherever you see k, you just substitute it with 2k plus 1. And then he showed that if you pick any algorithm of the type star, and remember, I had introduced that algorithm of type star earlier, you will always satisfy these two inequalities. The first is your f of yk minus f of x star is always upper bounded by, this is some constant C1, and this is k plus 1 square. Okay, so you can't do anything better than k plus 1 square in the denominator. Okay, and the same thing, yk minus y star is always greater than or equal to 1 over 8 y0 minus y star. So whatever your initial distance was, your distance at the kth iterate is going to satisfy this inequality. Okay, so this gives you a fundamental lower bound on what you can do, what you can achieve by an algorithm of type star, where you are using all the information about the past gradient in order to compute the gradient descent step. Okay. Now, I want you to contrast this with the rate of convergence for the steepest descent. In the steepest descent case, your f of xk minus f of x star, let me just use yk, is less than equal to some constant c1 over c2 plus k c3. Okay, so this is 1 over k. Remember, this is 1 over k.
I want to ask real quick that x star and y star in 1 and 2 are referring to the same thing, right?
Yes. I'm so sorry.
Okay.
X star.
Thank you.
This is x star. Yeah, sorry about that. Yeah, it is x star. All right, so this is the... So there is a gap, okay? So using steepest descent, this is the best you can get, 1 over k. C1, C2, C3 are constant, so you kind of ignore it. Because you are dealing with very large-scale optimization where k will be much, much larger than C1, C2, and C3. On the other hand, he says that, look, the lower bound actually is 1 over k square. So there is a gap. There is a gap between what you can achieve using steepest descent and what you can achieve perhaps using a more intelligent method that uses the past gradients in a very intelligent fashion. So that's what his claim was. Okay. Now he doesn't do it only for the convex function case. He does it also for what is known as strongly convex function case. So I'm going to go over that now. So strongly convex function basically means that your second derivative of f is less than equal to capital MI and greater than equal to small MI for all x. And m is greater than zero. Capital M is greater than zero. Okay, capital M also is the Lipschitz constant for gradient of f. So capital M is also Lipschitz constant of gradient of f.
What's the error symbol next to the lowercase m?
This identity?
It's an I, okay.
Yeah, Thank it's you. An I identity matrix. Okay, so for the strongly convex case, he defines what is known as condition number. Q. Capital M over M. And he defines a function f from R infinity to R. So this function is a convex function of sequences, like, you know, a vector with infinite elements in it. Let me just tell you what the expression looks like. F of x equals to m q minus 1 over 8. X1 square plus summation xi minus No, this is also small m. Okay. Okay, so this is my function f, and this is also convex, and it's actually strongly convex, and it satisfies this condition. Okay, and for this strongly convex function, his claim is as follows. Yk minus x star is greater than or equal to square root of q minus 1 over square root of q plus 1 raised to k y0 minus x star. These are all two norms. And fyk minus fx star is greater than or equal to
Professor, just to clarify, this is q or root of q minus 1, not q minus identity.
Yeah, this is root of q minus 1. So q is a real number and...
Oh, okay.
Yeah. Okay, so these are all two norms. So here again, he says that no matter what sort of algorithm you pick from star, your gradient descent such an algorithm will always have this as lower bound, where you're using all the past gradient information. That algorithm will always satisfy this particular lower bound, no matter what. So pick the best algorithm you can, which is tailored to this function. You cannot beat this lower bound in terms of convergence rate. And now I want to contrast this with the convergence rate we studied for the strongly convex function case, where we had, so this rate of convergence was discussed in the class maybe a couple of classes ago last week. And there we had mentioned that xk minus x star square for the steepest descent case is less than equal to q minus 1 over q plus 1 raised to 2k. Let me not put k, not xk, yk. y0 minus x star. Non and f of yk minus f of x star is less than equal to so this is what is achievable using steepest descent. Okay, and here again, we see that there is a gap in the rate of convergence. Okay. Let me recap once more, okay? Let's start from the very beginning of this class. So we started with the steepest descent method. It's the best, not the best, but it's one of the gradient descent methods where you pick dk equals to identity, okay? And then the only thing that needs to be chosen is alpha k, which is the step size. But what you noticed in the steepest descent is you are kind of discarding all the information you have accumulated in the past, and you're just using the current information of the gradient. And people back in 1980s thought that this is quite wasteful because we already have that information. Why not use it intelligently for doing a better, coming up with a better gradient descent algorithm? So the question that was posed is, can we devise an algorithm? And we are going to call in this lecture algorithm of type star, where xk plus one is x naught plus some linear function of all the gradients you have computed so far. Okay, and definitely we want to be faster than the steepest descent method. What do we mean by faster? We just want to get to the solution in fewer number of iterations, or get approximately close to the solution in fewer number of iterations. Okay, so we need to quantify what's the ultimate fast we can go, what's the speed of light for algorithms of this type, which uses all the past gradient information. So Nesterov thought about it for quite some time, and back in 1980s and in his book, in his 2004 book, he summarizes it, all this stuff, very nicely. So I highly encourage you to read the book. He basically said, let's consider two situations. One is the case where the function f is convex and gradient f is Lipschitz. And then he devised a function and showed that no matter what algorithm of type star you pick, your f of yk minus f of x star is always greater than or equal to some term that decays as 1 over k plus 1 square. So c1 over k plus 1 square, that's the decay rate for the value of the function or the optimality gap. So this is known as optimality gap. Okay, so the optimality gap decays as 1 over k plus 1 square.
Professor, yes. Just one quick clarification.
Yes.
This yk and y0 notations you're using, they are some x, right?
Yes, they are some x. Yeah, they are all in Rn. So yk is in Rn.
Okay, got it. Thanks.
Right. So in the steepest descent case, of course, yk plus 1 equals to yk minus alpha k gradient of fyk. Right. Whereas in the accelerated case, your yk plus 1 equals to y0 plus some linear combination of gradient of fy0 gradient of fyk. Okay. So that's the difference between these two algorithms. And for the steepest descent, you know, it can be shown that this is actually less than equal to c1 over c2 plus k c3. And so we see that there is a gap. There is a gap because this is decaying as 1 over k, whereas the lower bound is decaying as 1 over k square. So we need to fill this gap, hopefully by coming up with a more intelligent algorithm here. And then he did this for the convex case, and then he did it for the non-convex case, where he again came up with a convex function, which is actually a funny convex function because it acts on R infinity, not on Rn. But nonetheless, what he showed was that yk minus x star is upper bounded by some term that decays as square root of q minus 1 over square root of q plus 1 raised to k. And this term decays as the same term raised to 2 multiplied by some constant, which depends on the initial condition. Whereas if you pick the steepest descent situation where you are discarding all the past gradient, the rate of convergence is q minus 1 over q plus 1 raised to k, right? So, and here it's square root of q minus 1 over square root of q plus 1 raised to k. So again, there is an optimality gap. Sorry, there is a gap in the convergence rate, and we could potentially do better. And so he came up with a methodological approach of coming up with class of momentum-based algorithms. So that's what I want to talk about next. Okay, is the motivation clear now? Any question at this point of time? Perfect. So how do we come up with an algorithm that meets this lower bound that we have computed for those specific convex functions? So he calls what is known as estimate sequences. Okay, so the definition of estimate sequences is you have phi k from Rn to R, and you have lambda k. I think lambda k has to be positive. This is just lambda k in R. Lambda k is positive. K equals 1 to infinity. Okay, so I have this sequence of functions and a sequence of positive numbers is an estimate sequence of f from Rn to R, if and only if The first requirement for the estimate sequence is lambda k must go to zero. And the second requirement of the estimate sequence is phi k of x must be less than or equal to lambda k has to be greater than or equal to zero. This must be true for all k and for all x in Rn. Okay, so this is just an estimate sequence. This is just a definition. So I want my lambda k to go to zero, and I want my phi k to be upper bounded by a convex combination of the function f and phi zero. Okay, so what's the purpose of this estimate sequence? So he comes up with the following result. If xk is a sequence, k equals 1 to infinity, such that f of xk is less than or equal to minimum over all x, phi k of x. So this is the hypothesis, okay? Then fxk minus fx star is less than or equal to lambda k phi zero x star minus fx star. Okay. So now the question is, we would like this number fxk minus fx star to decay with respect to k in some particular fashion, right? That's what our goal is, that we want to come up with an algorithm which does that. And what he says is, as long as we can show that we can pick phi k and lambda k in some special manner, so that this condition is satisfied by a certain algorithm which generates xk, then we can show this upper bound pretty easily. And since lambda k goes to zero by assumption, it implies that this particular right-hand side will also go to zero eventually, because this term is constant. It's phi zero x star minus fx star. So it only depends on x star and the initial function phi zero and the function f that we are trying to optimize. Okay. So now the goal is to come up with this sequence lambda k and phi k in such a manner that this condition is satisfied and it meets the order optimality result that we need. So 1 over k squared for f being convex and a term that decays with respect to k, exponentially with respect to k, if f is strongly convex. So what class of algorithms can we come up with? That's the question, subsequent question that needs to be answered. And for that, I'm going to talk about the, at this point of time, any question on this particular estimate sequence definition and consequence? I hope the roadmap is clear. So basically, first we get the lower bound on the convergence speed, and we recognize that there is a gap between the speed of convergence for steepest descent and the speed of convergence with the best possible method that uses all the past gradient information. So once we recognize this, then we need to come up with an algorithm that bridges that gap. And this is an intermediate step of estimate sequence where you try and understand how exactly can we show that your fxk is converging in the right, at the right speed using the algorithm. And this estimate sequence turns out to be a very useful method to show that convergence. So he came up with the following algorithm, Nesterov's accelerated gradient method. And this, I think, was devised in 83, if I'm not wrong. Yeah, 83. In this algorithm, you have, I have already used yk and xk. So let me use zk equals to yk plus beta k. This is a step size. Beta k is a step size. yk minus 1. And your yk plus 1 is zk minus alpha gradient f at zk. So you could pick potentially alpha equals to 1 over m, and you could pick beta k equals square root of capital M minus small m. This is for the strongly convex case. Now, if you want to go through the derivation, it is like 6 pages of derivation to get to this particular algorithm, starting from estimate sequences. But the idea, I think the key ideas are already introduced in this lecture. So if you want to go back and read the chapter 2 of Nesterov's book, you will find a very detailed discussion and the proof for why this particular algorithm, why this algorithm is meets the order optimality result we are looking for. And note that the entire information about the past gradient is embedded within this within this function zk, and then you just compute one gradient of the gradient of f at zk, and then you do the update term, and then you know proceed with the next step of the algorithm, and that's how you incorporate all the gradient information that you have computed so far. So it is mathematically elegant. You don't have to store it in your memory, all the past gradients. All you have to do is store it in your memory, an additional vector in comparison to the gradient descent step. So remember, in the gradient descent step, steepest descent, you would be running the algorithm zk plus 1 equals to zk minus alpha gradient of f zk. Okay, so this was the steepest descent. And I want you to contrast this with this particular algorithm, which is Nesterov's accelerated gradient method.
So in this case, bk would be constant throughout the algorithm?
Yes, so for the strongly convex function, so Nesterov mentioned that you can pick a different BK, beta k's in order to improve your convergence. But even if you pick your beta k equals to this, you will get the same order of, same rate of convergence, but the constants may be different. You see what I'm saying?
Yes.
Yeah. Okay, so this is Nesterov's accelerated gradient method, and what we have discussed is basically Nesterov's train of thought before he devised this particular algorithm. And in the similar vein, I want to talk about Polyak's momentum method. This was devised much earlier in 64. So Nesterov's algorithm was devised in 83. Polyak's method was devised in 64. And Polyak, if I understand correctly, was a mentor for Nesterov. So Nesterov knew what Polyak was doing, and perhaps some of his work was influenced by Polyak's earlier work as well. So his algorithm, Polyak's algorithm, is xk, well, I'm using yk, so let me use yk plus 1 equals to yk minus alpha k. This is also called heavy ball. This is called heavy ball method or Polyak's momentum method, and this is the momentum term.
And the value for BK for this,
how would you go about finding that? You know, I didn't find values for this particular algorithm anywhere.
Okay.
Yeah, I think it should be, let me make some guesses, but you can then 1 over capital M plus M, or maybe 2 over capital M plus M, and beta k could be, I just don't know what should be. Well, yeah, maybe I don't know what the trial and error. I guess that's what I would do if I have to run this method. But actually, it's not given in the book. Not even in Bertzicker's book, but let me make sure before I exercise 1.3.8. Okay, good. So I found something. So 0 less than alpha less than 2, 1 plus beta over capital M. This is for the quadratic function. And beta has to be between 0 and 1. So I'm getting this step size for the quadratic function, fx equals to half x transpose qx minus b transpose x. And this is exercise 1.3.8 of nonlinear programming. Third edition. So the official text for this class is second edition, but I have third edition of the book. So there is some discussion about momentum methods in that book as well. Okay. And now there are many other accelerated methods that builds upon on top of these Polyak's momentum method and Nesterov's accelerated gradient method. And one of the things that that's a very hot topic for research right now is that Nesterov's method, they are trying to extend it to non-convex problems, particularly trainings with neural network or deep neural network in the machine learning community. So that's why momentum methods has picked up a lot of steam very recently because it converges to the solution much faster than steepest descent. And therefore, people are trying to come up with various ways of making it work with non-convex deep neural network training type problems.
And in all these problems, does the limitation of the convergence rate that Nesterov found hold, still hold?
Well, you know, the problem is that all these convergence bounds were derived for convex problems.
Mm-hmm.
And now you are trying to implement it on non-convex problem. And you know, the issue with non-convexity is as follows. You know, let's consider this function. This is a non-convex function. But if you look at just this region of the space, it actually is very, very convex function. I mean, it looks very convex function. Same thing here, right? So when you are training neural network, it's quite unclear what the landscape of the function looks like because those functions are basically running over a million dimensional or a billion dimensional vector. So in neural network training, your F is of the order of 10 raised to 6 to R, right? So you just don't know what the landscape looks like. And you would like to pick an appropriate value of alpha and beta so that the training works in an accelerated sense and beats steepest descent by order of magnitude. So that's where most of the research is happening. You know, I always say in my class that non-convex functions are almost always convex in small enough regions, but not globally. You know, convexity is a global result. And non-convexity is also a global result. But you know, if you look at a piece of that function, you probably will be looking at a convex function. Although globally, that is not a convex function. Right? So that's just something I always keep in mind when I'm dealing with nonlinear programming type problems. Okay, so that's all I have for today. Next, we are going to talk about optimization over convex set on Monday, and we'll then subsequently talk about projection theorem and so on. Coming up with gradient descent methods for minimizing non-convex, or not non-convex, but non-linear functions over convex sets. So that's all I have, and thank you for your attention. I'll have a good weekend, and I'll see you guys on Monday. My office hours is going to start in 15 minutes. So those of you who have questions, please do stay back for the office hours. Bye.